In this figure, we want to look at the Weibel model of the respiratory tract. And the Weibel model shows the branching pattern of the respiratory tree and how it's divided up into two main zones, the conducting zone here on the left and the respiratory zone on the right. Now, we are tidal breathers, meaning we breathe in and out of a blind-ended bag, if you will, a very complex blind-ended bag. And so we're going to see air moving down this very complex series of bronchiolar branching to reach the alveoli shown way over here on the right side. And what we find is that there are actually about 23 divisions to generate the enormous number of alveoli out here at the end of this respiratory tree, 300 million, in fact. We'll see the purpose of that in just a moment. Now, the conducting zone exists largely to get the air to and from the respiratory zone. And it is known also as the anatomical dead space because it is a portion of the lung volume that does not allow for gas transfer from blood to air and air to blood, right? That's obviously the purpose of the respiratory zone over here on the right. Now, one of the important components of this massive division is to generate all of these individual alveoli. And if we come down to look at this graph, what we find is that the cross-sectional area of the conducting zone is very, very low. This is important. Its volume is very low. And this is essential because that anatomical dead space is not serving our purpose of gaining oxygen and removing carbon dioxide from the body. However, when we go over to the alveoli, right, we start to find that our cross-sectional area, the volume, increases dramatically, right? And if we look at our Fick's law of diffusion, J-diff, right, or diffusive flux, equals the diffusion coefficient times, right, the surface area available for that diffusion, which we start to see becomes enormous. And so that's a very adaptive for maximizing gas transport. Now, we also rely on a partial pressure gradient, as well as a very small distance, as we'll see in a moment, over which that diffusion of gases must occur. Now, if we come down below here, we see that we have a lining epithelium to this respiratory tract. In a conducting zone, that epithelium is largely pseudostratified columnar, and it is ciliated. And one of the things it does is it produces mucus, right? We see right here. And so we have these goblet cells and then multicellular mucus glands that are producing mucus onto the surface of this epithelium. Then, of course, there are these cilia, right, that would be found on the surface of those cells that are sweeping that mucus towards the pharynx, right, to be disposed of in the GI tract. We swallow it. This is protective. It's called mucociliary defense. This is protective because air contains a lot of airborne particulate matter, dust, airborne bacterial spores, and other potential pathogens, and we need to remove those from the respiratory tract. When we get down to the alveoli, we certainly don't want mucus, and we don't want a very thick diffusional distance, right, a thick layer of cells here. And so our cells become squamous or flat. This minimizes our diffusional distance, right? So we can point to our delta X here, right? We want this delta X to be small, right? Short distance across these cells. That'll maximize our rate of diffusion over here. One other thing we see is the presence of cartilage in our conducting zone. That helps stabilize the wall and helps avoid collapse during forced exhalations when our intrathoracic pressures can get quite high. Finally, down here at the bottom, we see that there's smooth muscle through the conducting zone and then into the respiratory zone. That smooth muscle in the conducting zone isn't really well understood, as it certainly doesn't, our trachea, for instance, doesn't contract to sort of adjust airflow through it, right? It might add to the stability of the wall, but it's not really that well understood. When we get down here into the respiratory zone, that smooth muscle is going to become more important in generating resistances to airflow, adjusting resistance to airflow, to shunt air from one region to another, helping maximize our gas exchange. We want to match the ventilation, the airflow, to perfusion, the blood flow. And this smooth muscle will help us to do so.